Dudley Moore has a new film, and these two guys are largely responsible for it. I'd like you to meet the director and the producer of the new Dudley Moore film called Unfaithfully Yours, Marvin Wirth, to my immediate left, and Mr. Howard Zieff.
Yes.
Did I get that right?
Extend the E's.
Zieff.
Yeah, no, Zieff.
All right, which of you two has the harder job, the producer or the director?
Depends who you ask.
That's right. Ba-dum-bum. Well, I think he has the harder job because he's put up with my temperament. Right. I don't know.
You'd have to do the other's job in order to really know, and it depends on the movie. You mean on this movie or
yeah,
on another?
Yeah.
It's always, it depends on the movie,
yeah.
I think.
Yeah.
That's a very difficult physical job, directing.
I was
aside
just
from everything, aside from creativity or talent, physically, that's a very difficult job.
Generally, the producer doesn't have to get up at 5:30
right.
in the morning.
Well,
that's one of the joys of being a producer.
The producer does because he can't sleep.
Producer gets up at 5:30, but he doesn't have to. The director has to get up at 5:30.
You know what Dudley Moore does, at least for me? He gives so much. He says so many of the things and does so many of the things a lot of us would like to do and like to say, but we hold back.
Mm.
We really hold back. Like, for example, we might say to Dudley, how did you get the job? And he'll say, I slept with the director.
But he did.
But see, he says those things. He does.
Yeah,
we
right.
want to do that,
right.
but we hold it. We'll say, oh, they'll think I'm a homosexual or they think I'm a lesbian if I say that.
That's
but he's, he does.
Well, he has an outrageous sense of humor. I think that comes out of Beyond the Fringe and a Good Evening, you know, working with people.
And he's really Bette Midler, isn't it?
Yeah, but he does have that.
That
he's that way constantly.
Many of the same network.
Yeah.
Does he give you more? In other words, do you have
more
to tone him?
More?
More? Does more give you more? You have to tone him down. You have to say, oh, come on, that's way too much, Dudley.
Oh, well, he has a basic instinctive attitude about where the scene should go. I mean, he doesn't really overact, if that's what you mean. He goes as far as he thinks he should go, and he interprets quite well. But sometimes he'll be filled with energy, and the director's job is to edit back a little bit. But he definitely is very inventive. You'll get gifts from him that you won't get from another actor.
So you don't really have to say to him, all right, at the count of one, you pick up the coffee cup. At the count of two, you put it to your lips. He does that. You don't have to do
that. Oh, no, no, no. There are things that you call. You don't teach Dudley Moore how to move. He moves beautifully. But there'll be things such as, you saw the film.
Yes, oh, by all
the
means.
The scene where crushing the pills.
Yes.
With now, that had to be carefully choreographed. So that was a mutual choreography. Because it was all in one take. I started with the pills, pulled back, saw him trying to roll the can over it, then chop it. The spritz had to happen at a certain time when the can blew up. All of that had to be carefully choreographed, but that came out of both of us, not just me saying, do this on the count of one, two, and three.
It was dreadful. Well, he didn't bother to review the most, so he won't bother with this. No. Because I went through this last year with this. I do not want to. Are you all right?
Yes, just coffee.
Don't bring them. Just, okay. You promise me that, huh? Sunday, 4 o'clock at Juilliard. Okay. You got it. I don't care. I'll see them.
I'm glad you two got together. What a wonderful background you have, and especially a relationship with Lenny Bruce. Why is it that people could not accept his what he did with the language? We talk that way. In real life, we really do.
Only to but not to judges and our mothers and to school teachers, right?
In anger, sometimes we do.
Okay. Yeah, that's true. Well, that's what he was talking about. Not just language. That's what he's remembered for, unfortunately, but he talked about hypocrisy, period, about how hypocritical we all are. And people don't want to hear how hypocritical they are, I guess. But now they do. They accept it now. They accept it in comedy terms now. I mean, there's kids out there doing all that, and it's accepted. But I think the first of anything is always tough to get
mm-hmm.
pushed in. Everybody, I think Lenny's, if you can call it a mistake, he didn't know it at the time, was saying the same thing about organized religion. And that really got him in trouble.
Well, I'm glad you stayed with the project long enough to put it on stage and film.
Thank you.
Because he must have been a tough guy to deal with.
Lenny?
Yeah.
No.
No?
No. Lenny was very sweet, very sensitive. I mean, tough, you know, there was arguments and the performers, but no, he was not tough to deal with. It was tough to deal with when he got the disease that he got, and like anybody is in the throes of that.
Mm-hmm.
But not before that, not as a person.
Mm-hmm. What does a film like this cost to do? Yeah, you're the producer. What did it cost to make Unfaithfully
Blood.
Yours?
Blood
and my name is
I don't hide budgets, but I also don't like to throw budgets around, because then people have a tendency to critique films based on budgets, when really the below the line on most films, and the below the line for those of you who don't know, there is everything except the stars and the actors and the producer and the director's salaries are the same, more or less. I mean, within a range, unless it's a musical or there's some special thing, it's the amount of days you shoot and they're all about the same. And so it really becomes costing more to do films only by the stars that you put on top of it. And then people have a tendency when they say, well, that costs $20 million. Of course it should be good for $20 million, or of course it should be good for 12. And it's really a false thing. They're all costing the same. That small budget film they're saying is great because it only costs that amount of dollars, is it's really false. But the film cost $31. No,
was it that?
It cost over $10 million.
See, I was thinking of things like
it cost
this.
Over $10 million.
Over $10 million. You, as a producer, have to look at the bottom line. I'm certain.
Right.
All right. When you have a scene where you're going to use.
Everybody does. He does too. I mean, everyone has a responsibility.
Oh, the director really has it.
Yeah, we all signed that budget
because they say you're going over. The big. When you ask a director, how's he doing? He says, I'm 2 days ahead. Or I'm only half a day behind. They don't tell you how the film is.
You don't know until it's done anyway.
Yeah, they just let you know they're on.
Everyone has a responsibility. Everyone signs the budget, and everyone is penalized if we go over budget.
Well, I was thinking, did you use? Was it the Los Angeles Symphony Orchestra?
Mm-hmm.
Philharmonic.
Did you have to?
Philharmonic.
The Philharmonic.
Pinkus Jokerman, Los Angeles Philharmonic.
Then do you have, like, for example, do you have to pay them their union wages and all that?
Yes.
Now, I would think that in your position, you might say, well, wait a minute. Now we could get actors to pretend to be playing and then use music.
You're not allowed anyway, and you couldn't do it.
Really?
You couldn't pull it off.
You
need a musician. You need someone who can play the instrument, and I'm making a musical right now I'm shooting, and besides doing the pre-records on it, we need musicians who, and I'm using the same ones who pre-recorded it, paying them again, because they have to play the exact same thing. It's like lip-syncing to a song. They have to do the exact same.
This is in a movie where, like in the old Cornel Wilde or whatever movies, his fingers would be hidden behind the keyboard and he kind of rocked it.
Or they cut to someone else's fingers, that kind of thing. This is the musicians having to do it and do it well.
Well, this film has been in the works, at least in your mind's eye, for about 10 years,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
And unfortunately, you were going to cast Peter Sellers, the wonderful Inspector Clouseau,
mm-hmm.
officer of the Loo, decorated by the poop. I love that man. Why did he die? Everyone's dying.
Yeah.
But I'm glad you stayed with it, too.
Yes. Well, that was a blow to us when he died. And we kind of, the picture dissipated for a while because we all went in kind of a shock thing. And then when we got back together to make the film, it began a new search, a totally new approach to the picture. It was not the approach that we were going to do with Peter. It became a much more real person who fell apart.
Yeah.
Peter was going to start from the top. He was going to be a very sophisticated, worldly, European type, of like von Karajan or Giolini, rather than a very human person like Dudley played.
And how fortunate that Dudley is able to perform so well musically.
Oh, yes.
Comedy, actor.
Couldn't have been done otherwise.
No, even the conducting.
Have you gentlemen seen Terms of Endearment?
Yes.
Did you like Terms of Endearment?
I liked it very much.
Terms of Endearment was shot in Lincoln, Nebraska, the first film we've ever had in Lincoln, Nebraska.
Oh, yeah?
I want you gentlemen to consider the next film that you
do,
that it is you can do it on your own terms.
You're a real booster, aren't you? I mean, you are a real chamber of commerce. That's terrific.
You don't have to read that right now, but use it in your spare time, and we'd love to
that's
have you come.
That's very nice of you.
We will treat you very nicely, gentlemen.
Oh, thank you.
You have a very funny film. Mm. See? I'm well balanced.
Great.
The producer and the director of the new Dudley Moore film called Unfaithfully Yours. Stay tuned, 10:11 Morning continues.